Hi, my name is Wale Osofisan. I work with HelpAge International as a social protection advisor for fragile states. This report actually was a research that was funded by the German Federal Ministry of Economic Cooperation and Development. It's a broad research that had to do with social protection generally in developing low-income countries in Africa. And there was a part of the project that looked at fragile states and to look at the relationship between the states and the citizens, the relationship between the states and citizens using cash transfers to build that relationship. An overview. The first one will be to look at cash transfers, the assumptions out there that cash transfers can actually help build state-citizen relationships. And we looked at three case studies, Northern Kenya, Sierra Leone, and West Darfur in Sudan. Now, in the context of state fragility, it's imperative that we consciously try to move the debate and objectives of cash transfers beyond vulnerability, risk, and poverty reduction. And there's the assumption in the literature that if cash transfers are well designed intelligently, they can be used as instruments to address a central underlying feature of state fragility, which is the absence of a functioning state-citizen relationship. In many fragile states, I'm sure a lot of us are aware that you have the state which is completely divorced from the rest of the society, and the idea that a commitment to a cash transfer can actually build that relationship. And the potential gains here are that beyond improving the living standards of vulnerable groups, it will also create an opportunity for them to exercise their rights as citizens. And for the state, the benefit includes increase in its legitimacy and popular support, and also an opportunity to strengthen state institutions, which are critical for conflict prevention, recovery, and promotion of state resilience. In other words, cash transfers have the potential to strengthen state-citizen relations and, by extension, the legitimacy of the state. Based on those assumptions that you find out there in the literature, we decided to ask a very, very simple question, that to what extent do cash transfer programs strengthen state-citizen relations? And we picked three case studies. One was Sierra Leone, which is the social safety net program, which is a government-funded, government-implemented program in a post-conflict situation. The Hunger Safety Net program in Kenya, which is a donor-funded, NGO-implemented cash transfer program in a food insecure environment, which is also fragile due to its topography. And the third was West Darfur. Now, West Darfur does not have a cash transfer program, but a normative case is made for one. And the presentation today will focus more on Sierra Leone and Northern Kenya. Right, okay. I won't go too much into the methodology. It was basically qualitative, semi-structured interviews with local chiefs, government officials, and focus group discussions with beneficiaries and non-beneficiaries. There's a section in the report detailing the methodology, and so you can grab hold of a copy and look at that if you're interested in that. Now, I'll go to the findings. Now, the Sierra Leone's Poverty Targeted Safety Net Program. This was a program that targeted older people, 60 and above, who were considered to be extremely vulnerable without regular source of income. And beneficiaries in focus group discussion and non-beneficiaries alike in 12 chiefdoms, 12 chiefdoms were sampled out of 65 chiefdoms where the program was implemented in the pilot phase. There was a general consensus that the selection criteria was very, very unfair in all 12 chiefdoms that were sampled. And just to sum up, the first quote was from an older woman in Bogo Town, which they call it Bogo Town, but as far as I'm concerned, it's a village, a glorified village for that matter. And, she says the chiefs were responsible because, as in why it's so unfair, the chiefs were responsible because they influenced the people that came from Freetown in order to favor some people who are related to them or people they like, but they are still our brothers and sisters. I hope the next time I'll be lucky to receive the money. I will keep praying. Now, in fairness to the chiefs, when you ask the chiefs what went wrong, they all tell you that it's very, very difficult for them to actually select the most vulnerable older people in a context where almost everyone is poor and vulnerable. So no matter what they did, they will always blame them, you know, for excluding certain people. Now, what are the implications, in Sierra Leone for state-citizen relationship? Program credibility was completely damaged, and you know, the issues of power relations were not taken into consideration when the program was being designed, because in all the 12 chiefdoms that were surveyed, even the local chiefs were desperate to also benefit from the cash transfer themselves. So it was heavily manipulated. The selection criteria was heavily manipulated, and the program ended up undermining, you know, the relationship between the local chiefs, which is the state at the lowest level of governance, the relationship between them and the people, you know. So there was the program was actually unable to have a positive impact on state citizen relations. Now, what were the limitations and the challenges? First, there's lack of reliable data, especially at the local level. So how do you target who is the poorest when you don't have even the basic, you know, data? And this leaves room for leakages and abuse, you know, in the implementation of the program. Another key limitation, which is an element of, you know, the fragility in Sierra Leone, is the weak institutional capacity. For instance, the social safety net program team, the monitoring and evaluation unit, used 2 motorbikes to monitor the program in the entire northern region. Only 1 member of staff had received training on cash transfer programming. So they had no clue what they were doing, even though the government had good intentions, you know, to implement a cash transfer supporting poor, vulnerable, older people. From an infrastructural point of view, Sierra Leone is a very, very poor rural country. 95% of Sierra Leone is very, very rural. And there are so many communities that are not even accessible by road. So a lot of older people who are the most vulnerable were actually not able to benefit from the program because they lived far away from the chiefdom headquarter towns. So they were completely excluded. So the intention of the government was to target the most vulnerable, but they couldn't reach them because of the poor levels of infrastructure. And in Sierra Leone, in the rural areas, there's zero telephone coverage. Once you leave the main town centers like Freetown, Makini, or Bo, you know, there's no telephone coverage. So the issue of transferring cash through mobile technology is completely ruled out in Sierra Leone. And there are no post office and there are no banks as well. So it makes it even more difficult, which meant the social safety net staff had to take cash in brown envelopes to pay beneficiaries. And, you know, from reflection, I think it's quite unfair to send a poorly paid government official who earns less than $200 a month, you know, send them with about equivalent of $100,000 to go and pay poor people, you know, in a rural area. You can imagine what will happen, you know, along the way. And one key challenges and limitation of the SSN was that it wasn't linked at all to any other government-provided services. For example, it wasn't linked to the, you know, to national ID card. So how do you identify people? People were being identified, you know, randomly. You know, there are even high possibilities that Liberians could have benefited from the cash transfer. So there were no linkages at all, you know, to the national ID card system. Now, for Northern Kenya, in contrast, and unlike the SSN in Sierra Leone, national ID cards were required for recipients to receive cash, you know, to receive cash and for beneficiaries to receive cash directly. If beneficiaries don't have ID cards, they need to register someone to receive that has an ID card to receive that on their behalf. The HSMB program actually had unintended impact on state-citizen relations, not by design, but by default. And the incentive that it created for people to apply for ID cards meant that a lot of older people that did not see the value of having an ID card now applied for ID cards, which meant they could participate in the electoral process, in the democratic process, which means they could vote. So I think it's important that we don't miss that bit of, you know, the impact of cash transfer programs. Oof, I have 5 minutes. Oh. Right, okay. there's evidence, you know, from registers of person in Turkana, Wajir, and Mandera that there's been a massive increase in the number of older women, especially applying for national ID cards. Now, let me spend a few, you know, about a couple of minutes to talk about the social protection rights component, which also played a very, very strong role in actually, you know, creating that unintended positive impact on state-citizen relationship. The rights component had rights committees. We were meant to monitor grievances within the parameters of the program. But what we found was that there were spillover effects, you know, to areas beyond the parameters of the program. Because of the introduction of a rights discourse into the community, you find the rights committee members also educating the communities and rallying them through collective action to also demand for services from their local authority. That, again, is something that we shouldn't underestimate, the value of introducing a rights discourse into designing and cash transfer programs. And there are so many examples of success stories of, you know, successful collective action taken for road reconstruction, demand for electricity supply, and all that. And you can find quite a number of that in the report. I won't go through them here. Right, okay. So I just have 5 minutes, so I'll just skip to the next slide. Now, this is an important quote from one of the chairmen of the right committee members, who said, "At first, people fear to ask things from the government, but since we received the rights education, the community is now asking for a number of things. We always ask in a respectful way and not in a rude way. Even the chiefs are now fearful because we are asking questions without fear. We need more training so that we can continue to monitor what our leaders are doing with our resources," you know, which is, you know, very, very good indeed. Now, the limitations of the Younger Safety Net program, obviously, is because it's the donor-funded, you know, program and NGO-implemented program, you know, and that limits its ability to contribute to state-citizen relationship on a sustainable basis and in the longer term. And it would be great to see phase two of the program, include the government more in its, especially in areas of implementation, although there are issues with the new constitution and whether the Ministry of Northern Kenya, which is meant to be coordinating it, will still be there, you know, in years to come. Sudan, as I said, you know, there's no cash transfer there, but a normative case is made in the report for one as well. Now, I come to the conclusions. Based, you know, on the findings in Sierra Leone and Northern Kenya, there were emerging issues, you know, that actually influence the ability of cash transfer programs to have an impact on state-citizen relationship. The first one is the nature of program design, and the second is the nature of program ownership. In terms of program design, it's clear that poverty-targeted programs do have a huge challenge to implement in fragile states and environments with very high levels of poverty, a low institutional capacity, and unreliable data. In the case of Sierra Leone, anomalies associated with program design had showed program design and implementation, including institutional and infrastructural constraints, did have adverse effects on state-citizen relations. In Northern Kenya, on the other hand, the right-based approach, included in the HSMP, showed how spillover effects empowered citizens by giving them a voice, you know, to demand for services at the local level. And lessons from both Sierra Leone and Northern Kenya can also be learned in terms of designing and implementing cash transfers in the future in Sudan. In terms of program ownership, the positive aspect of the Sierra Leone program was that it was 100% government funded. So it was a government funded program. Although bear in mind that Sierra Leone is heavily reliant on the donors for budget support, but it was a government funded program, so it was completely nationally owned, while the HSMP was largely owned by a donor with limited engagement from state institutions. The Ministry of Northern Kenya coordinates the Hunger Safety Net program, but it's not really directly involved in implementation. I mean, I will conclude by saying, you know, in reflection, for the purpose of building and sustaining state-citizen relations, I think it's important that government should be encouraged to take full responsibilities for design and implementation of cash transfer programs. Donors and NGOs can certainly play a role by complementing government in supporting them in building necessary institutional structures and infrastructure, such as an MIS system, Management Information System, and strengthening their monitoring and accountability system, as well as supporting civil society, you know, to hold the state to account. Finally, there were areas of research that I thought were worth considering in fragile states. I think it's important that, you know, the donor community and NGOs should, you know, look into issues of civil registration and record keeping in fragile states at the local level. You know, because without those basic structures, it's very, very difficult, you know, to have you know, meaningful, not only cash transfer programs, but you know, social programs. Then, as issue of mobilizing domestic resources as well, you know, through let's say redistributive tax system, which incorporates the informal sector, you know, so as to provide sustainable funding for cash transfer programs and wider social protection programs. Finally, I think there are other areas of learning, you know, that we can, you know, look into. You know, Nepal, Kosovo, and Timor-Leste, who they are fragile states, who have also put in place, you know, cash transfer programs, you know, as a way to build societal reconciliation and citizen relations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Wale. Now I'd like to invite Nicola to take